Thank you. So how are you guys doing? Great? Great. How was last night? Did you go to the party last night? Yeah, okay. Have you guys talked about how exciting this session will be? No?
No.
No. Good. So we have a lot of, it's good that you guys are not geek enough. Yeah, good. So we had a slightly problem before we start this session. I don't have my computer because my computer doesn't connect to the projector. Seems like I use Linux, so it seems like the projector doesn't like open source. So I have to move to closed source program here with Windows. So, okay, this topic is about configuration management. So some people ask me whether I'm going to talk about features. Actually, we will talk about beyond features, what we can do beyond features before Drupal 8. That's kind of like what we're going to do in the sessions. I will have demo as well. Actually, my demo is my computer, but luckily I record the demo so I can play some here in this closed source system. And before we start, just make sure we are on the same page so nobody gets lost about whether I'm supposed to be here or not. So this session is about configuration management for Drupal 7. I'm not going to touch configuration management initiative in Drupal 8, so we are not going to go there in the sessions. And this is for intermediate level. So if you think you are advanced, you're probably not supposed to be here as well. But if you are beginner, you probably can stay here. So you probably pick up some new information. And also, because it's site building, we are not going to see any code. So if you want to see code, probably this is not a good session for you. And so this is basically for people who build a lot of sites and have a pain how to build a site and basically how to distribute configuration to other servers or to other environments. And I need a cheat sheet because there's a lot of things. So I need to make these things in progress as it should be. But if you are not sure, you can stay here for a bit and see how this goes. But we'll let you go if you don't think you're supposed to be here. So feel free to go if you think you won't get any information. So, and also I will make this semi-interactive sharing session. So I will ask you questions about things. But I know that I'm basically in the way between you and the lunch. So I'll make this really quick, and I will keep all of the question and answer in the end of the sessions. So for people who are really hungry, they can go, and people who are really hungry of knowledge, they can stay, right? So, having said that, having these sessions, I hope this session will give you something that you can implement in workflow, or at least you can think about after the sessions. All right, so let's start. I will introduce myself. My name is Aradi Nur Rizal. And as you can see, I have apostrophe in my name, and that's not a typo. That's actually illegal character in my name. That has been screwed a lot of government systems in the past, especially the booking ticket and then the immigration system. So I'm actually Indonesian, just close by, just like 7 hours swimming. And currently, I'm living in Sweden. I'm working for this company. It's called Wunderkraut. Wunderkraut is actually a merger between four companies. I was in not one before. Maybe you have heard about this company. Have you heard about this company? Yes? Yes, I was in not one, and now it's merged between Wunderkraut. And just in case anybody wondering, that thing is not a carrot. This is actually a radish with a green top. Okay, I've been basically doing Drupal since 2006. Started with 4.6, Drupal 4.6. What I did is I did a lot of pro bono job with nonprofits. It means that I don't get paid. If I don't get paid, I don't want to maintain code. If I don't want to maintain code, I will make my Drupal as least custom code as possible. What I want to do is I build the site, I give it to them, and then point them to Drupal.org for any documentation. That's what I did. So since I don't have any code, I don't have any custom stuff, I have a lot of configurations. And it's a bit of pain to transfer all of the configurations. So what we will cover in the sessions, we will talk about what is configuration management, a different way to manage configurations, features and configurations, how does it difference? A lot of people confuse about what is features, what is configuration. And we will talk about module as well, features module and configuration module, the new one, which is actually backported from the Drupal 8 CMI. So we can use it. I will do the demos so we can see what we can do with configuration module in Drupal 7. And maybe demo. Do you guys want demo? Are you sure? You're not really sure. Are you sure? Yes? Yes! I love demo. So we'll do demo afterwards. So, if anybody familiar with this term? Anybody?
Yes.
Okay. So anybody is not familiar with this term? Okay, so I will explain a bit. Log, usually we use a local environment. Dev is development environment. STG is stage environments. PRD is production environments. So what is the difference? It's local environment is your environment and your laptop. You do your hacking and development in your local environments. And development environments is basically an environment that you share with other developers to make sure that your code doesn't break the other guy's code. In some Drupal shop or in our company, we use CI, continuous integration in dev. So the guys who, the program that built the dev is Jenkins in our guys, but you can use other like a chef or other stuff. And also stage is basically a server or an environment that the client see. So the client will see the stage and they probably will do some adjustment in stage. But for sure, if your client not supposed to touch the production. If your client touch production, give them a lesson or fire them, doesn't matter. But production not supposed to be touched. If they want to change stuff or they want to play around with the site, play in stage, not in production. Production is the sacred place. Try not to open UI in production. In our company, we actually does not enable the UI model. So if we have like Fuse and we have Fuse UI, we turn off the Fuse UI, that kind of stuff. Because we don't want to actually open the UI in production. So what is configuration management? This is my interpretation of configuration management. Configuration management is organization and coordination of configurations of a site to accomplish defined objectives. What is defined objective is usually based on user case, user story, and so on. Organization is basically how you organize your organization. Coordination is how you coordinate your configuration with other developers or in different servers. And what is configuration? We will talk about it during the sessions. So, oh, that was supposed to be a surprise. So, there is a lot of way to do configurations management, like how we manage configurations. And I've been doing a lot of configuration management. So I've been doing a lot of methodology, basically, a way to do configuration management. And as you can see, because I spoiled the surprise. The first method is the click and pray method. But this is me, basically, doing the click and pray method. You guys know about this method? Are you familiar with this method? No? This method is basically you go to the production, you clicking around, and then you pray, nothing breaks. That's basically the method. And this is a good method if you are really, really religious. If you are not, probably you're supposed not to go there. And also, if you really, really know your site, then but it's not suggested. I did that well back when I did my blog, because I really know my blog, and I know that nobody came to my blog, so doesn't matter if it's down for 1 week. Okay, and the second method is the dumb method. Dumb method, what is dumb method? Anybody knows about dumb method? Maybe, sorry? Sorry? Yeah, true. So the dumb method is basically you do a MySQL dump, and then, you know, do your stuff, and then put it back to your production site. There is a drawbacks of this method. Anybody knows what is the drawbacks? Anybody? Sorry? Yeah, but you can do MySQL dump and then turn on the site again, right? Doesn't really matter. Yeah, exactly. If you have like dynamic content, you basically will rewrite the dynamic content. It's good if you have only static content or like my blog, where nobody actually come, and I am the only one who doing the content creations. So that's the dumb method. The next one is the paper tissue method. Oh, I have no source because I took this photo, so there is no copyright issue in this. So what is the paper tissue method? Anybody familiar with this one? No? Yeah, exactly, yeah. So you basically do your changes in your local, you write down what you did, and then after that you do the same thing in production. Or in the more professional way, you will have like deployed document, basically. So for instance, one programmer do all of the changes, and then usually there is only one guy who in charge with the deployment, is the guy who know how to do the server stuff, and that guy will basically follow your documentation, what you did in the local. This is good as well, but there is a drawback as well. I mean, if you do this, you don't have to put your site down. I mean, you still have your dynamic content, but what is the drawbacks, you think?
Human error,
anything else?
Repeat yourself.
Yeah. Sorry? Exactly, or 3 times, or 4 times, or a lot of times, right? And especially if you work with different developers, I mean, okay, I did the changes, and then I write the document. I have to make sure that everybody in the company understand my writing, right? And then what I wanted to do. And then you, as the second developer, need to do the same things as I did. So that's costly. Right, and then after that you have this local develop, and then you have this development server, you have this stage server, you have this production. That's repeating a lot of stuff. That's expensive, basically.
And if you step up, then you still do it on the live.
Yeah, exactly. So you need to go and open your live set and make sure everything's okay. It's basically pray again. So the next one is the hook method. Anybody know about this hook method? It's why it's always the same guy. Let's go to. Okay, what is the hook method? Nobody knows. Okay, hook method is basically you create the hook update function, and and you do the set update, and basically you do a lot of stuff in your hook update function. There is actually a session today about hook method. If you want to know, there is a session around 3:45, I think, that we'll discuss about the hook method. But I'm not going to talk about this. There is another guy who will talk about in depth. So what is the drawbacks of hook method, you think? I mean, you have to write code. You don't like it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And not everything Drupal has a nice API, you can just do, you know, make something happen. You know, sometimes you might even have to directly manipulate the database.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And also remember when the client can poking around and change stuff in stage. With the hook method you go like local dev stage and production, doesn't actually go backwards. It's difficult to make it go backwards. So for instance, if the client say that, oh, I don't like this, I mean, well, I want to make like the text field 10 characters longer, right, in the settings. And you know, the client know how to do Drupal, kind of. So they're clicking around, and then, hey, can you make this as the base of the next development? Then you kind of like a bit screwed. Because then you have to create the hook update, and then basically mimicking whatever the client did, if they remember what they did. If they didn't, then you have to look around. That's kind of like one of the drawbacks. So what else is the drawbacks of these things? Hey. But there is advantages of this method. I mean, you can basically do a lot of stuff with the hook method. Like for instance, adding user or adding taxonomy terms and so on, which you cannot do with features. And then the next method, the FU method. I'm not putting the pictures because I'm not putting pictures. Because probably a bit problematic if you put it on. So what is FU method? Anybody knows what is FU method? Yes, FU method is the trust command, the shortcut trust command to update features. So you do trust FU, and thinking somebody else when you do that. And then you update the features. Features is basically the current best practice how to distribute and organize configurations. And basically, features has two use cases. First, to group configuration into one package, and the second one to export and manage the configurations into features module. So features, anybody doesn't know about features, or any, a lot, all of you know about features module. Okay, so you know, okay. So basically, features module is basically you go to the features UI. Oh, this is a good thing about the features is you have UI now, and you're clicking around and then you're downloading the module in Torball, and then after that you unpack it, and then you enable the module. And that's kind of like how the features do. And because I'm kind of like lazy programmers, I don't want to do that. So anybody knows about features tools module? Yeah, features. One of the features tools features is basically you can just do one click, and then it will do the download, the unpack, and then the enable things. You have to check it out if you use features a lot. And also, one thing that I don't like about features is features auto-detect components. Like for instance, if you go and then select a content type, in the right side, you get like bunch of components that features pick for you. I mean, sometimes you don't want certain components because you know that this is, I don't want it to be in the features. At the moment, we use features plumber, so you can uncheck that components. But that's kind of like the workaround about it. Well, another drawback about features is it's not granular. I mean, you cannot make one feature for site information, right? Otherwise, you will have a lot of features. And since feature is actually models, and then if you have a lot of features, mean you have a lot of models. That's kind of like performance issue there, because you actually doesn't want a lot of models turn on in your production site. One of the reasons why we don't turn on our UI models. And also another drawbacks, if the component's already in one feature, you cannot add it in another features. It will be conflict. We will see like the, you know, needs review, something like that. So that's one some of the drawbacks that I find in the features that probably need to be solved. Then comes a new model called configuration management model. What it is? Anybody knows about what this model is? No? No. OK. Then you are in the good session, because I'm going to talk about this. Configuration management model is actually, we take a lot of concept from the 8 CMI, Configuration Management Initiative concept, especially the active store and the data store architecture. Now they change it to config store, because it's confusing, the data store. So basically with the active store and the data store is, active store is your database, and data store is your file. In features, your configuration located both in your code and in your database. So for instance, if you add custom fields, and then you export it into features, and you turn it off, the field will gone, right? So means that you have to have that features module on if you want to want that custom content type. And here, in configuration management module, the configuration is actually copied to the files rather than doing having both as the configuration. So the configurations only exist in the database level. It doesn't exist in the data store. The data store is only copy, is only a copy of the active store. So when we export, we copy all of the configurations to the data store. And configuration management will enable you to track specific configurations rather than the entire group of configurations like in features module. So you can basically track one information like site information, something like that, or only one field. So if you want to track that field only, you can do that in configuration management. And the configuration management module, you remember features has two use cases, the grouping and the distributing the configurations. This configuration, this module only dealing with the moving configuration between environments and sites. So a lot of people is actually confused whether this module actually going to replace features or not. It's actually not. Okay, so active store is actually a database. The configuration in your database, data store or config store is your configuration copy in your file.
And so then you would set up a configuration and it gets stored to the database where it's used from, and then it gets exported to a file only when you want it to move it to another site.
Exactly. because in features you have both, right? Okay, and basically this is how we do in configuration management, in configuration management model. So site A, you write the active source to data store, and then you do push with your version control system. And in stage, for instance, in site B, you do pull from your version control, and the data store will be updated, right? And then you import the configuration in your data store into the active store. And this is the source of this graph. There is a lot of information if you want to go there to delve. So replace features models. No, it's not going to replace feature model. It's supposed to work side by side with features model. Features supposed to do the grouping, and then the configuration management model supposed to do the moving the configurations. So what is the difference then? Okay, what is the difference between these two models? So let's use cafe analogy. Let's say we want to make a cafe, right? In a cafe, we will have a lot of menu like tea or coffee, something like that. Let's use coffee and tea because you guys like coffee. I don't like coffee. I like tea. So let's use coffee and tea. To make a coffee, what you do to make a coffee? You put coffee inside the water, and then depending on your client, depending on your customer, you want them, one of the client like the sugar in their coffee, some of them doesn't want sugar in their coffee, and some other guys like milk in their coffee, but several doesn't want milk in their coffee, because coffee need to be only coffee, right? And then I like tea, so I put tea in the water, and I like sweet stuff, so I put a lot of sugar, like that 6 sachets. And if you go to Singapore or Malaysia, they have what they call teh tarik. You guys know teh tarik? No. So teh tarik is basically you make tea with milk. You put milk in the tea. All right. So basically, then you have a tea, and then you have a tea tarik, right? The recipe is tea, only tea with sugar, and teh tarik is, the recipe of the teh tarik is tea with milk. That's the recipe. But you don't actually care about what kind of tea or what kind of milk in it, right? It's just a recipe that you write, and then you can give it to the other cafe so they can make the same tea. You get the analogy so far, right? So if I make a recipe or a features, I can give it to another cafe, another site, so they can make the same teh tarik, so with that recipe. And then, so what is the configuration then? What is the configuration then? The configuration is the ingredients, I mean, what type of ingredients it is, right? So for instance, he has one type of, the other cafe have one type of milk. I have, my cafe have other milk. So that's why there is two type of milks and two type of sugars there. So the recipe doesn't change depending on the ingredients. So the recipe can use the ingredients, and the ingredient can use the recipe as well. So for instance, wait, are you guys understand? Really? Very confusing. So basically, features is the recipes, configuration is the ingredients. It's not supposed to be related to each other, right? But if you use features models, if you want to change the ingredients, you basically change the recipes. The recipes, if you use features, you basically tell that, okay, teh tarik need to have a milk from a cow in India that is processed in Malaysia for 25 degrees Celsius during test kind of recipes that you will write with features. It's really, really specific. So for instance, if I give that recipe to another cafe, that cafe will have a lot of problem finding that ingredients. What if I just say that, oh, this teh tarik only need the condensed milk, and then you guys in Australia get the recipe, you can just buy any condensed milk in the grocery store. So it's easier for you. And doesn't really, and for instance, if the recipe changes because of somebody experiment and then find there is a specific kind of milk that they need to put in while doing the teh tarik, they can basically change the recipes, and then that recipes will be distributed around the cafes. So any questions on this? Example in Drupal space. Okay. So for instance, you make a site, a blogging site. And then this blogging site has a gallery, right? So gallery not necessarily to be in the blogging site, right? But in this gallery, you have image style, right? And this image style have its own configurations. So there is a full image, thumbnail, and so on. So a gallery need to have image style that has three styles, full, and original, and thumbnail. But the configuration of each image style is not necessarily the same in every site, right? So that's the configuration. Does it answer your questions? Yeah. Are you sure? Talk to me afterwards if you. Okay. Okay, so this is kind of like the summary of what I just talked. Ingredients are configuration, recipes are features. You can read it. Recipes use ingredients and features called use configurations. Ingredients and recipes should not have dependencies. The recipes need to be notified by the management system if the ingredient changes. This is how features module and configuration module can work together. So the status of the configuration management. This is a talk that has been presented in DrupalCon Munich. I was there. And there is some changes after DrupalCon Munich. At the moment, there is no version 1. It's only version 2. But if you clone the repository, there is a version 1 in it. But you don't bother because it's not supported anymore, so use version 2. In version 1, we didn't. The model did not have a trust command, but now we have trust command in it, so you can use your continuous integration workflow for this configuration management model. And there's a lot of things that need to be done. The roadmap and the milestone are in this URL. Basically, what it need to be done is implementing the patch system, and there is a caching information that need to be done because it's a bit slow right now, and the ability to remove configuration variable. The model doesn't have that at the moment. It need to be done. Removing configuration variable means that if you doesn't track your variable again, and there is no way to remove that. At the moment, you need to use hook update to do that. That's the status. Oh yeah, and at the moment is alpha 2. There will be alpha 3 in a couple of months, and maybe a few betas. And hopefully in July or August, it will be stable. But it's already good enough at the moment. So you can, Sorry?
If you are starting a project now that was a 3 month lead time, you know, yeah. would you recommend using it?
If you are religious, yeah, probably. No, I'm not using it for any production at the moment, so.
So you're still practicing.
Yeah, exactly. But you can play around, and this is basically backported from Drupal 8 CMI, so it's a bit similar what we have. While waiting for the Drupal 8 to be mature, we can use it at the moment, maybe around July or August. Yeah. So, for Drupal 7.
For
Drupal 7.
Wrong.
Okay. No. Exactly. The module is backported a lot of concept from Drupal 8. I mean, yeah. The funny thing is the guy who do Drupal initiative, Greg, he used to be working for Not One as well. So it's a lot of stuff going on with the CMI. And this module already supported a lot of components, like content types, fields, vocabularies, basically C-tool stuff, and also contributed modules like VisiWeek, Views, Display Sheets, other and roles. This is the reference. Basically, if you want to know the latest supported components, you go to this URL. So if you are interested and then you think that this is way to go for Drupal 7, these modules need a lot of testers. If you doesn't have time to help with the development, at least you do the test. That's the least we can do, because the project is kind of like a haunted mansion because nobody there. So yes. Database store, active store or data store, config store.
The database one.
So
the active store is not its own tables.
No.
It's just injecting things where you normally find.
Active store is the Drupal database, and then data store is the files.
Yeah.
So this module will basically injecting this configuration to the database. So, demo?
Yeah.
How's the time?
25 minutes.
So we can do demo and then after that question and answer. So, let's try with updating configurations. I record this, so I will basically speak on top of the video. Okay, so we have two sites. Can you see the URL? Yeah, it's basically log.cmm.drupalconsydney.dev. That's the local environment. Right, that log. And then I have another site called stage.cmm.drupalconsydney.dev that we will use as the stage environment. Okay, and this is basically the configuration management UI. The UI and the module itself is a separate module, so you can basically turn off your UI. In your production, you don't need it. Actually, you can turn off the configurations module in production. And then basically, there is a contact type, image style, permissions, vocabulary, field, permissions, what I'm going to do. And let's go to the field, and then change stuff, edit. And we type This is a body. And then we change the row information to 30. And we save. And then we change the permission. I need to search for content. This is the content. So we check the, so authenticated user can create a new content and edit their own content. Right. And then we save it. And after that, we reload the local. And then do the processing. And it detects that it's already changed. So you can see what is the difference between the change. It's similar to features, other one, yeah. And in permissions, oh yeah, to do that, you have to install diff module. So you can see what it has been changed. Right. So you can select one of the components and then write active store to data store and exported a lot of stuff, including the things that we, all of the permission that we change, and then we check the git, and then we git update all of them. So we update to the repo, and we pull, and then we see there's all those things change, and then we go to the stage. What I want to show that nothing has changed, but I find a bit difficulty to find the permission. Where's the permissions? It's over right there. No, go back. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's just in time. I don't touch the computer. So basically, you see that this is the one in the stage. So there is no permissions. And when we if we open the body over there, it's over there. And then we let's go back a bit. So here, we check that in the stage, the article is not, the permission for creating new article, or sorry, yeah, creating new article is not for authenticated user. And in structure and in content types, we go manage field. Remember that the body is still body, not this is a body. And what we need to do is basically you go to the configuration management in stage, hit synchronize and synchronize configurations. Synchronize with the data store. We already pulled the data store. Right. Yeah, right. So you, sorry. Synchronize everything in the data store.
So, yes, so you can't selectively.
Yes, you can. You can. If you go to the tracking, you can basically select one and then import to active store. This is just to make you easier. So you do the synchronize configurations and everything imported here. And then if you, so the article before the import is body and let's refresh and this is a body. that's how you do it in the configuration. And then the same things with, it's thirsty now. And the same thing with the permissions. You refresh it, and then you get all of the permissions. And that's one thing. And let's use.
Can you just show us, could you just show us briefly the terminal where you did the git pull?
Sorry?
Can you just show us briefly the terminal where you did the git pull from?
Okay. Oh, okay. This is kind of like the setup for the demo. So we have this local CMM DrupalCon Sydney.dev. I'm sorry, I didn't explain it. I was so excited to do the demo. So this is the site, and then this is the data store for this site, and this is the stage, and this is the data store for this site. And what I did is basically I just cloned the config from the local to the stage. So I don't have to push. In the stage, I just pull. So maybe if you work with a lot of developers, you have like your central repository like GitHub or Bit or other your own server. But here, I only have two repositories, the local repositories, and then the stage repository, which is actually cloned from the local repositories.
The config there, it looks like it's stored in a file directory.
Yeah, it's actually a file directory.
So clients could potentially go in and
This is inside the default files, and then you can actually change the URL. It doesn't matter. So you can put it outside the root directory if you want, or you can actually put in your remote server if you want. So it's really flexible. Yeah, just by default, if you install the module, it will create a config module inside files by default. But then after, you can change it.
So you're changing the config in a content type there. If that content type is checked in a feature, would that conflict?
The question is whether it's conflict with the features. At the moment, features will track the configurations. Features will say it's overridden, but in the future, features supposed to get the information from the configuration management. Okay. Also, you. It's like features. Like exportable from CTOS, yeah. Okay, let's. Oh, I'm supposed to repeat the question because it's recording. Sorry. So the question was, what is the format of the file? This is like a features. Okay, done. So let's skip the adding vocabulary. Basically, you can add vocabulary. And then the terms, but I like this one, which is adding a new content type. So basically, this is the local. So I create a content type, new content type. I can probably kind of speed it up. Actually. Yeah. Yes, I got custom field one. Got this is not necessary. I got custom field 2. Sorry? Yeah. And then basically in tracking, if you want to track a new stuff, you go to not tracking and then click and then start tracking. If you click start tracking, it's only if you click start tracking in the right side, it's only it will only track the that components. If you click start tracking in the bottom, it will check for all of the dependencies. So it will import a lot of stuff. I will. No. For instance, page changes is when we import, for instance, if we have content types, more than 20 fields, without patch, it probably stops somewhere, and then we will get like 70 seconds delay. That's what it is. But
does the start and stop checking just mean which ones are going to be synchronized?
Yeah. Yeah. We can basically see like, it's pretty granular, like set informations, one permission, one menu. You can select which one you want. Well, if you want to do it with features, you have to create one feature for each stuff.
So if you had 800 configurations,
yeah.
You added 30 new content types, and changed 50 permissions, et cetera,
yeah.
Would you have to go through each of those variables and track them?
If you want, yeah. But there is a function to, you can select all. There is here. You can go click all. Or if you use trust, there is a function that I created, which is track all, because you want track all, basically, maybe. And you can do there is a all function, all options in the trust.
Just backtracking a little bit, you said that you could actually pull the configuration file from a remote server. Is that already available in the settings? Is that where you point it to where it's going to find its config files?
Yeah. There is a migrate here. Migrate will export all of your configuration into a tarball that you can put in other sites. But in the settings, I cannot click it because this is video. You can basically put the URL, and then there is an option whether it's actually a remote server or not.
You would point that URL to the tarball?
Yeah. So any folder, basically. I don't think so.
The reason I ask, sorry to digress, but can you imagine a useful scenario where you've got a single repository of the config files on a remote server, it's getting pulled from several sites, and as you change it, you then pull it from those sites, and then they'd also be pulling from their own unique locations as well?
That's probably.
Is that what you had in mind, or would that be?
We are not thinking about that at the moment. The Drupal CMI doesn't, Drupal 8 CMI doesn't actually go that way. But maybe if you make a feature request, that would be, or maybe you can create your own model and contribute to us. That would be great.
It's a good idea.
Sorry?
It's a good idea, though.
Yeah. And okay, so let's continue. So we track new stuff, we track new custom, and then you can track it one by one. Or you can just hit stop tracking in the that one that I just clicked. Sorry?
Let's start tracking it. Can you hover it? Oh, you can't hover it.
It's a Ajax
call.
Yeah.
So when you click start tracking, is that quite a little Ajax behind?
Yeah. I forgot to repeat the question again. Okay. So I'll speed it up. Basically, you got the new untracked files here, which is actually the new content type. Right? What I want to do, you know how to do code command. You go to stage, and you see. There is no new content type here. And what you do is basically go to the synchronize and hit synchronize configurations. All right. And if you go here, content types, and then you refresh, your new content type is already there. Yes. I'm not using features in this example yet.
Okay. Okay.
There is no features involved in this.
Okay. Yep. So technically, if you make your module compliant configuration, you don't need any more features?
If you want to make your module compliant to configurations, you basically want your configurations to be in your module to be transferable. You use features when you want to group configurations, like when you have like views, panels, and other configurations, and you want to group them into one. Like for instance, you want to have like gallery features. In this gallery features, you have views, you have image styles, you have maybe panels, then you group them. But you don't use features to track or you to use features to track or transfer the configuration. You use the configuration module to do that. Yeah, how we differentiate between content and then the
to kind of clarify what he's asking, so menu links were in there. Menu link the points were no.
Yeah.
How do you manage the disconnect there between an exportable menu link, which references a node, which isn't exportable? Is that kind of,
Yeah, menu links will have a kind of like URL to a node, that's what you mean, right?
Yeah.
And then that information is basically configurations, but the node is content, right?
Yeah,
so then basically if you change that and then you export it and the content is not exist, then we'll break, basically.
So that would actually be somewhere where you would use features to give that explicit content that you needed to.
Yeah, but I don't think you can export features, content with features, no? You need contrib modules or something like that. I think not, yeah, I think not export work with features. I'm not really sure. Yeah, you can use UID to do that as well. Okay, 5 minutes left. So this is what I want to show you guys. The big difference that I like about features compared to features. So you have, I already imported the new content type, and what I'm going to do, I will turn off the modules. In features, if you turn off the features module, you won't get anything, basically. So if I can find one. So I turn off that, the UI. And then I turn off the configuration management. And if you go back to content type and I refresh, I still have my content type, which you cannot do with features at all. And then you can have all of the stuff. This is one of the advantages of using this module. And there is another demo, but I will put it on my blog. I hope it gets more views. So wrap up. So we have talked about configuration management. We have talked about different way to manage configurations. We kind of know what is different between features module and configuration modules. Please do try this module and use it and tell the community what you think about it. We had suggestions, and I think it's good if we can put it out there. So we need basically more testers and maybe some help with the developments. The credits is actually not for me because I only submitted a couple of patches. There's a lot of guys that is in the project configuration that you can see that has a lot of comments.
That's what I was going to ask. Are you yourself patching both the backport and the D8 version? Are you working on both?
No, I'm not.
Just on the backport?
No, I'm not. Oh, okay. I'm basically the guy who liked this model. And do some improvement based on what I think I need, basically what I think is good. So can be you, can be you, can be you as well. I just live close to Sydney, so I'm here. So thank you. And this is the configuration project links. And this is the wunderkraut.com blog. You can see a lot of interesting stuff from my colleague. And this is the blog that I was mentioned that has no visitors at the moment. So, and I hope you enjoy the session. I hope you get something. At least you can you get something to think about during the weekend. Maybe you can try the model. And please don't forget to give feedback. It's really helping me to improve my session in the future. So thank you.